This presentation has been pre-recorded. Following the presentation, there will be a live question and answer session. If you are having difficulties hearing or seeing this meeting, please identify your issue in the chat box or email us at arsp@ppd.mncppc.org. This meeting will be recorded and shared on the website. Please be muted with your video off for the initial portion of this event. If you would like closed captioning, please click the three dots icon and choose that option. Please find a link to the project website as well as the project email address in the chat box. Now I would like to walk you through tonight's agenda. I will first briefly describe where we are in the sector plan's legislative schedule. The project team will present highlights of the preliminary plan and proposed sectional map amendment for the Adelphi Road UMGC UMD Purple Line Station area. Following the presentation, we will conduct a live question and answer session based on the material presented tonight in the preliminary plan and the proposed SMA. Questions should be submitted in the chat box, and staff will answer as many questions as possible before the end of the meeting. You may also use the raise hand function if you wish to ask a question verbally. Staff will unmute you on a first-come, first-served basis, time permitting. Finally, we will wrap up and remind you of the next steps in the process. The Prince George's County Planning Board and the Prince George's County Council initiated the sector plan in the fall of 2020. The project team released the preliminary plan and a proposed sectional map amendment, or SMA, to the general public on October 28, 2021. We invite you to carefully review the preliminary sector plan and the proposed SMA. A link is provided in the chat, and encourage you to attend the joint public hearing on January 18, 2022 at 5 o'clock p.m. and or submit written testimony before the close of the public record on Wednesday, February 2, 2022. To present your views to the Prince George's County Planning Board and Prince George's County Council, sitting as the District Council. Speakers at a joint public hearing are provided 3 minutes to speak, so we invite everyone to submit their feedback in writing. In March and April 2022, the Planning Board will review all the testimony presented during the joint public hearing, conduct a work session with staff to analyze the testimony, and make any necessary amendments to the plan or SMA. The Planning Board will then adopt the plan, endorse the SMA, and transmit it to the County Council for final approval. Upon receiving the plan and SMA from the Planning Board, the County Council will also review the public testimony, conduct a work session with staff, and then in June 2022, either approve or recommend further amendments to the plan or SMA. If the County Council recommends amendments that are not based on the public record, including public testimony, they will hold a second public hearing in September 2022 on those amendments and would then approve the plan in October 2022. Please find links to the preliminary plan and the proposed SMA, as well as a link to the joint public hearing in the chat box. Now, I would like to introduce members of the project team present here tonight. First, this is our project core team, project facilitator Scott Rowe, project manager Shuba Punase, deputy project manager Michael Calamese, and team members Arnaldo Ruiz, Garrett Dickerson, and Andrew McCray. Also on the project team are team members Sarah Benton and Brian Bird. I would also like to introduce the members of our production team, Brian Bird and Max Van Allen. Please note that tonight's virtual open house event is for informational purposes only, and we are not seeking any formal comments on the preliminary sector plan and proposed SMA during this meeting. As shown on the slide and mentioned previously, all formal comments on the preliminary plan and proposed SMA should be submitted in the form of verbal and or written testimony for the joint public hearing schedule for January 18, 2022 at 5 o'clock p.m. You may sign up online to speak at the joint public hearing by 3 o'clock p.m. on Monday, January 17, 2022. The e-comment portal will be activated at 5 o'clock p.m. on Friday, January 14, 2022, regarding this plan. You may also use the portal to submit written testimony. For those unable to use the portal, comments and written correspondence may be emailed to clerkofthecouncil@co.pg.md.us or faxed to 301-952-5178. All testimony and comments received by the deadline will become part of the public record of the meeting and, when feasible, shared and noted at the meeting. Testimony and comments will not be accepted via social media or by telephone voicemail message. Please note that written testimony or comments will only be accepted in electronic format. If you have questions about this preliminary plan that are not covered tonight, please feel free to email us or request a virtual office hours meeting with us. You may also go to our project website for all the information and updates on this plan. Check out the project FAQs, Frequently Asked Questions page for answers to some of the general questions you might have on this sector plan project. We look forward to hearing from you. And now I will hand it over to our next presenter.
Good evening and welcome to a presentation of highlights from the preliminary Adelphi Road, UMGC, UMD Purple Line Station Area Sector Plan and Proposed Sectional Map Amendment. The 2021 preliminary Adelphi Road, UMGC, UMD Purple Line Station Area Sector Plan is a proposed comprehensive community plan to implement Plan Prince George's 2035, the county's general plan. By creating a new neighborhood adjacent to the Adelphi Road, UMGC, UMD Purple Line Station. Upon approval, the Adelphi Road, UMGC, UMD Purple Line Station Area Sector Plan will supersede the 1989 approved master plan for Langley Park, College Park, Greenbelt for the portion of Planning Area 66 within this sector. This plan will amend portions of the 2014 Plan Prince George's 2035 approved general plan, Plan 2035, and countywide functional master plans. This sector plan contains the vision for the Adelphi Road, UMGC, UMD Purple Line Station area, along with goals, policies, and strategies to implement the vision through the 8 planning elements identified in Plan 2035. This preliminary sector plan is accompanied by a concurrent proposed sectional map amendment, SMA, which recommends the zoning changes necessary to implement this plan. The Adelphi Road, UMGC, UMD Purple Line Station area consists of over 102 acres adjacent to the proposed Adelphi Road, UMGC, UMD Purple Line Station and the intersection of Maryland 193, University Boulevard, Adelphi Road, and Campus Drive. The plan area is south of the University of Maryland Global Campus UMGC headquarters and south and west of University of Maryland College Park UMD. The plan area includes portions of the cities of Hyattsville and College Park and is located in Councilmanic Districts 2 and 3. The plan area is located within Plan 2035's established communities, Plan Subregion 2, and Plan Area 66, College Park, Berwyn Heights, and vicinity in the northwestern area of Prince George's County. The project team used a variety of methods to assess the existing conditions of the sector plan area and the immediate area around it. This included demographic and market data analysis, site visits, surveys, stakeholder listening sessions, and the community meetings to help develop that understanding. This slide shows the numerical snapshot of the Adelphi Road sector plan, primary market area, which consists of a larger area beyond the sector plan boundary. Please refer to the sector plan area market study for more information on this. When developing a sector plan, a key factor planners look at is the demand for housing, not just in the fixed geography of a sector or planning area, but also in neighboring communities. A key factor in determining housing demand is identifying the nature of the existing and anticipated supply. In other words, what types, sizes, or sell rent price points are available in the surrounding area. This sector plan's primary residential market area, or RMA, incorporates portions of the city of College Park and many neighborhoods outside the city of College Park, including Adelphi, Calvert Hills, Riverdale Park, and University Park. The sector plan area rental market serves UNB students seeking off-campus options, as well as university staff and younger couples. The market for rental housing also includes UNB's large base of faculty and professional staff, some of which could be attracted by the new quality and rental and for sale communities proximate to the university. Households with one member employed by the university and another commuting to a job elsewhere in Prince George's County, Montgomery County, or the District of Columbia could find a Purple Line station location particularly appealing. There's a limited supply of high-end multifamily residential offerings throughout the area for faculty and staff. Age-restricted developments in the sector plan area could attract active seniors interested in downsizing from their homes, including University of Maryland alumni and current and retired staff and faculty. On April 15, 2021, the project team led the community through a virtual community visioning workshop to help define the vision for the future of the sector plan area. Project team staff and consultant partners facilitated conversation using multiple discussion rooms and the use of Mural, a digital visual collaboration tool. Based upon the community feedback received during this visioning workshop, the project team developed the vision and goals for the sector plan area. A draft of this document was shared for the public comment May 27 to June 9, 2021. The following vision statement resulted from the workshop. In 2047, the Adelphi Road, UMGC, UMD Purple Line Station is the center of a unique, vibrant, welcoming, inclusive, and accessible neighborhood that serves as a gateway to the University of Maryland. Residents live in a range of housing options that are walking distance to jobs, classes, recreational opportunities, and exceptional public transit that connects to jobs throughout the broader region. This sustainable community focuses on providing safe access to local amenities and regional destinations throughout a network of open spaces to relax, gather, and recreate.
Before we begin highlighting the recommended policies in the preliminary plan, let us take a moment to discuss how the policies have been organized in the plan. All sector plans in Prince George's County are guided by and implement Plan 2035, the comprehensive plan that provides a vision for the entire county. Plan 2035 provides 8 plan elements, and all master and sector plans since the 2014 adoption of Plan 2035 are made up of the following elements: land use, economic prosperity, transportation and mobility, natural environment, housing and neighborhoods, community heritage, culture and design, healthy communities, and public facilities. Breaking down a plan into these elements is a way to organize the complex factors and considerations that affect and are affected by growth and development. You should notice a lot of interaction between the plan elements. Let us now begin with land use. This slide shows the recommended policies for this element. 1, create a high intensity, mixed use, pedestrian-oriented and university and transit-supportive neighborhood at the Adelphi Road UMGC UMD Purple Line Station area, also known in this context as the UMD West Campus Center. Discourage non-transit-supportive or automobile-oriented uses. 2, preserve key publicly owned natural areas to preserve environmental assets and create buffers between the UMD West Campus Center and adjacent neighborhoods. 3, encourage and support the consolidation of parcels to facilitate the envisioned development. And 4, assist property owners with the redevelopment of their properties. As you see on the future land use map on this slide, the sector plan recommends mixed use throughout the sector plan area except for the two parcels shown in green representing parks and open space use, and one parcel for institutional use shown in navy blue color. Please refer to the preliminary sector plan section 3, land use, for more information. Please take note of the map on the left. In 2018, the Prince George's County Council adopted a new zoning ordinance, subdivision regulations, and landscape manual that will go into effect upon the council's approval of a countywide map amendment, or CMA, which was proposed by the planning department, but not yet adopted as of tonight. This sector plan was developed assuming approval of the proposed CMA and can only be implemented by the zones in the 2018 zoning ordinance. Now, please take a note of the map on the right. The sector plan is recommending zoning changes in the core and edge areas of what is classified in Plan 2035 as the UMD West Campus Center. Properties within the core areas, shown in dark pink on this map, would be zoned to facilitate higher intensities of mixed use, pedestrian-oriented, and transit and university-supportive development closest to the Purple Line Station, UMD, and US 1 Baltimore Avenue. These areas would be placed in the local transit-oriented core zone, or LTOC zone. Edge areas, shown on this map in light pink, would be rezoned to facilitate less intense development between the core and the existing low-density single-family neighborhoods to the south, and would contain a mix of residential units with ground floor amenities and community spaces focused on the needs of residents. These areas would be placed in the local transit-oriented edge zone, or LTOE zone. Two parcels within this sector plan are excluded from the UMD West Campus Center boundary and zoned as Reserved Open Space, or ROS. The purposes of the Reserved Open Space Zone are to encourage the preservation of large areas of trees and open spaces, to protect environmentally sensitive areas, and to provide for a limited range of public and recreational uses. Please refer to the proposed sectional map amendment for more information. Please note that the preliminary plan recommends additional natural areas within other properties for conservation in the form of resource parks. Section 6, Natural Environment, and Section 2, Public Facilities, of the preliminary plan include additional strategies for tree preservation. Let us move next to economic prosperity. The slide shows the policy recommendations for this element. 1, create a neighborhood destination by attracting high quality retail, eating and drinking establishments, and services to the Adelphi Road UMGC UMD Purple Line Station. And 2, leverage the proximity of the county's largest employer, University of Maryland College Park, UMD, and the University of Maryland Global Campus, UMGC, for maximizing opportunities for business development. The map highlights the corridors where the plan recommends ground floor commercial uses. Please refer to the preliminary sector plan, section 4, economic prosperity, for more information.
Let us move next to transportation and mobility. The slide shows the recommended policies for this element. 1, incorporate active transportation safety features, attractive streetscaping, and stormwater management best practices into all streets throughout the sector plan area. 2, minimize the potential motor vehicle traffic impact generated by all future developments in the sector plan area. 3, minimize and mitigate the environmental impacts of transportation infrastructure, facility design, and construction. 4, enhance active transportation infrastructure to support healthy and sustainable travel modes and attract businesses and employees. 5, increase connectivity through development of a comprehensive shared use path and trail network. 6, create micro mobility opportunities at key locations. 7, as development occurs in a sector plan area, explore the potential of increasing connectivity to destinations throughout the county by expanding transit services and amenities. 8, support the county's efforts to achieve Vision Zero Prince George's countywide interdisciplinary approach to eliminate all traffic-related fatalities and serious injuries. And 9, manage parking to encourage walking, bicycling, transit, and other alternative modes of transportation. Please refer to the preliminary sector plan section 5, transportation and mobility, for more information. This map visualizes the master plan of transportation complete Green Street recommendations. The preliminary plan recommends that all new streets, as well as all existing streets, be constructed or reconstructed to the appropriate urban street design standards within the 2017 Prince George's County Urban Street Design Standards, or the most up-to-date county-approved urban street standards. During redevelopment of the properties or through Department of Public Works and Transportation and/or Maryland State Highway Administration capital improvement projects, complete streets increase all users' sense of safety and security, help businesses and economic centers thrive, and contribute to an overall sense of place and community. These street design standards aim to ensure that all public streets, including privately constructed streets approved by the county, as well as publicly funded projects, are complete streets, which are safe, comfortable, and inviting to all users. The preliminary plan also recommends the construction of specific pedestrian and bicycle facilities, shared use paths, and trail connections. This map shows the recommended pedestrian and bicycle facilities. Sidewalks will be required on all streets within the sector plan area. The bicycle facilities are either in the form of bike lanes or shared use paths for many of the sector plan streets. On a shared portion of the street is recommended for shared lanes from bicyclists, since the street will be internal and anticipates low vehicular traffic. Please refer to the preliminary sector plan section 5, transportation and mobility, for more information. Let us move next to natural environment. The slide shows the recommended policies for this element. 1, preserve the maximum amount of existing natural resources practicable within the context of creating urban walkable communities. Ensure that the areas of connectivity and ecological functions are maintained, restored, or established. 2, proactively address stormwater management. 3, reduce urban heat island effect. Thermal heat impacts on receiving streams and public health reduce stormwater runoff by increasing the percentage of shade and tree canopy over impervious surfaces and use pervious surfaces. 4, preserve the tree canopy to support the conservation of the natural environment. And 5, support local actions that mitigate the impact of climate change. Please refer to the preliminary sector plan section 6, natural environment, for more information. Let us move next to housing and neighborhoods. The following recommended policy for this element is as follows. 1, construct a range of housing units affordable to students, employees, and seniors at transit supportive densities proximate to the Adelphi Road, UMGC, UMD Purple Line Station. Please refer to the preliminary sector plan section 7, housing and neighborhoods, for more information. Let us move next to healthy communities. The following recommended policies for this element are as follows. 1, create opportunities for recreation and healthy food access within the sector plan area. And 2, connect sector plan area residents to recreational and healthy food opportunities beyond the plan boundary. Please refer to the preliminary sector plan section 8, healthy communities, for more information.
Let us move next to community heritage, culture, and design. The following recommended policies for this element are as follows. 1, transform the area closest to the Adelphi Road UMGC UMD Purple Line Station as a landmark gateway to the UMD campus with a built form that presents distinctive design features that are inviting, safe, sustainable, comfortable, highly visible, accessible, and inclusive. Two, minimize and mitigate the impacts associated with new development on existing neighborhoods. Three, create an integrated and connected street and block layout that prioritizes pedestrians, promotes walkability, and provides safe and continued pedestrian connections within the sector plan area and to adjacent destinations. Four, highlight and celebrate the history and culture of the University of Maryland and of the broader community. And five, promote crime prevention techniques and sustainable green neighborhoods. Please refer to the Preliminary Sector Plan Section 9, Community Heritage, Culture, and Design, for more information. Finally, let us move next to public facilities. The following recommended policies for this element are as follows. One, minimize and mitigate the impact on school capacity from any new developments. Two, provide a variety of parks and recreational facilities in the sector plan area to create a vibrant transit-oriented development with public gathering spaces and areas, preserve environmental assets, and help address identified park needs. And three, ensure all residents are connected to parks, recreation, and open space. This map shows the recommended public open spaces within the plan. The plan recommends approximately 15 acres of conservation areas as resource parks, as well as 7 parks. It includes a plaza next to the Purple Line station as the focal point of this community. As you see on this map, the red dotted lines represent a variety of pedestrian and bicycle facilities recommended for safe connections to these parks and open space facilities. Please refer to the Preliminary Sector Plan, Section 10, Public Facilities, for more information. Now I will walk you through a graphic visualization of the sector plan area that imagines how the sector plan area may develop by the year 2047, or 25 years from next year. These concepts illustrate how the plan area may develop pursuant to county regulations over time. It should be noted that they are for illustrative purposes only and do not reflect required or mandated development. Market conditions will dictate the phasing, scale, and ultimate land uses developed. Here you can see the extent of the Adelphi Road UMGC-UMD Purple Line Station Area Sector Plan and its proximity to the future Purple Line Station and to the UMGC-UMD campus. Again, as mentioned above, this is a concept plan and is for illustrative purposes only. Here you can see a bird's eye view of the plan area at the intersection of Campus Drive at Adelphi Road, looking southeast. The Purple Line station is on the left. As you see, this location next to the Purple Line anticipates a transformative landmark gateway to the UMD campus with a distinctive design, creating an inviting, safe, accessible, and inclusive space. In this community, people can live, work, and enjoy proximity to all of the high-quality amenities that residents desire. The plaza is the focal point of the plan area. Ground floor retail is present alongside vibrant programming, which could include amenities such as a farmer's market or food trucks. The plan area is transit-oriented and prioritizes travel options that encourage and support active transportation, such as walking, biking, scooters, etc. Here you can see wide sidewalks and bicycle lanes that are present throughout the entire plan area, providing safe connections for pedestrians and bicyclists. Wayfinding, signage, public art, and banners all help in creating a sense of place with a unique identity as a gateway to UMD. Here you can see a bird's eye view of the plan area at the intersection of Campus Drive and a continuation of Presidential Drive, looking southeast. At the center is one of seven new parks recommended in the plan area, along with three conservation areas. These areas can accommodate community gathering space for residents and visitors with opportunities for lounging, eating at restaurants, fitness activities, and pop-up events. As you see here, wide sidewalks and bicycle lanes again provide safe connections for pedestrians and bicyclists. Wayfinding, signage, public art, and banners help in creating a sense of place for residents and visitors. This is a street level view looking into the plan area from Campus Drive. The sector plan recommends lots of multi-mobility options, including scooters, bicycles, and walking. A vibrant and activated public realm is achieved through ground floor commercial uses with transparent facades and outdoor restaurants and cafe seating. Additional pedestrian scale elements such as awnings and signage, and streetscape enhancements such as street lamps, benches, landscaping, wayfinding, signage, and public art enhances walkability. Again, the wide sidewalks and bicycle lanes provide safe connections for pedestrians and bicyclists.
Well, good evening and thank you. You probably recognize my voice. My name is Mike by now. My name is Michael Calamese, and I'm a senior planner in the long range planning section, and I'm also the deputy project manager for the Adelphi Road project. So that part of our presentation is over, and now we're going to move into the question and answer session. But before I do that, I just want to say that we want everyone to stay updated on the latest news about the project. We've been putting a bunch of links into the chat, and we will continue to do that for the rest of the night to encourage you to go to our website, to direct you over to our website, and just look over the course of the project and see what we've been doing as far as our community engagement and the different and the other community meetings that we've had. The market study that we reference is there. We've got a page of frequently asked questions, and we have how to get virtual office hours. So we just we encourage you to stay in contact, to stay updated. And I just want to address that someone asked a question, will we be providing the recording of this meeting on our website? Yes, we will be putting it up on our website. So if you are having trouble, technical difficulties, you'll be able to access it. And so now we'll move to question and answer. We would like for you to submit questions into the chat box, but I see that we have, let me deal with somewhat, Mike, you have your hand up. Why don't you feel free to ask your question, and then we'll get the Q&A started that way. But before you start, if you're a little shy, by all means, we would like for everyone to put their questions into the chat box, but we'll go ahead and take your question since your hand's up, Mike. Go ahead, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for this amazing presentation. There's clearly a lot of thought that's gone into all the different parts of it. It's really impressive. I had a kind of specific question. I'm wondering how the bicycle lanes will cross the purple line.
Okay, that's a really good question. And so what I will do is I will bring on our project manager, Shubha Panase, who will handle much of the question and answer, but we also have other folks who will be able to answer questions if need be. So Shubha, I would like to bring you to the floor now so you can introduce yourself to some and reintroduce yourself to others.
Thank you, Michael. And thank you, Mike, for the question. I'm Shubha Panase. I'm the project manager of this project. The bicycle lanes will be designed when the public facilities are the recommendations for the public facilities are implemented. The illustrations you have seen we have shown, it shows the urban design, urban street design standards. So based upon that, we have identified how the area would develop and how the street, you know, bicycle lanes and the sidewalks, those would eventually look like. We do have the our transportation planner here who can provide more information on what's the usual process, but all the facilities we are recommending in the sector plan area will be either implemented during the development of those properties by the developers or by the agencies. And during that development process, those designs would be finalized. I'll request Ben, Ryan, to add to that.
Hi, good evening. So for the bike lanes, so far we've planned to have them run alongside new roads as separated facilities. As far as the specific design of the purple line, we have not been in coordination regarding how bike lanes will cross the actual tracks. This will be one of the final design phases of this project.
Scott, you have the floor.
Yeah, I would just add, good evening, everyone. Scott Rowe, project facilitator. I would just add that, as Ben said, as a bicycle lane project moves from a plan into an agency's capital improvement program or part of a development project, that's something that the entity that's constructing the bike lane has to coordinate with MTA. There are dozens of bike lanes, bike trails, et cetera, that have to cross the purple line at grade throughout Prince George's and Montgomery County. So we're quite sure that MTA has design guidelines and design requirements for those crossings to make sure that they're safe and that bicyclists are protected from train traffic that's coming along.
Thank you. Thank you, Scott. We've got another question. I have to find my place. The next question is, and I'll start this off with Shuba again. When are the park projects expected to start? Shuba, when are the park projects expected to start?
I'll request Scott to provide some additional information on that. But as everybody is aware, this sector plan is a vision for the next 25 years. Some of the parks we are recommending are for public ownership. Others will be developed during the development of certain properties, which will be owned by private entity, private property owners, but will have public use access. It will depend upon once the plan starts getting implemented. It will be over the period of 25 years when we expect everything to happen. So nothing will be developed. All the parks are not going to be developed immediately within a year or two. So this is a long process, and I'll ask Scott to add to that.
Sure, Shuba. I would echo what you said that some of the parks, especially those that interior to the plan area, wouldn't occur until redevelopment occurs. So those would occur concurrently as a property comes in to be developed. We would want to work very closely with the Department of Parks and Recreation, with the property owner, to ensure that those public open spaces get built and that they have public use easements that allow the public to enjoy them and get the maximum benefit out of those. For some of the resource parks that we've identified that would likely be owned by the Department of Parks and Recreation, those are decisions that would be made in balance with other priorities around the county when the a department creates its annual budget and its six-year capital improvement program. So that's one thing that we always tell communities when we're out doing a plan in a community is that it's important for community members to stay engaged with public agencies and with the county's budgeting process and with the commission's budgeting process to advocate for the public open spaces in your community. Every year the commission does, has work sessions and has open houses to talk about their budget and their work program. And it's a great opportunity for community members to come out and advocate for park construction, for acquisition of property, which is a key thing we're recommending here. I think we've got some sensitive environmental places we'd like to see acquired for permanent preservation here in the plan area and in other places around Prince George's County. So that's something that would occur over the next several years in balance with other priorities around the county.
Okay, thank you, Scott. We are certainly happy to receive many of these questions. So let's keep going down the list. The next question, start again with Shuba, is why is the open area north of Campus Drive and east of UMGC not included in the sector plan area? This large area of land currently is used only for surface parking lots. So again, why not the open area north of Campus Drive, east of UMGC? Shuba.
Thank you for the question. So the sector plan area was determined by the county council when the project was initiated. This particular sector plan area, going to happen on the surface parking lot, that will be part of the master planning that University of Maryland is currently undertaking. It's going to start very soon by the end of this year. And we are anticipating that particular parking lot will be also redeveloped with high density mixed use and some complementary uses, having consistency with the sector plan recommendations in our sector, within south of the campus, actually. Scott, would you like to add something to that?
No, you pretty much got it. The county council, when it initiated this plan, directed us exactly where the plan boundaries were going to be, and that's the only area that we can plan for through this process.
Okay, thank you, Scott. The next question is how many housing units are projected? Are there existing apartments that are envisioned to be torn down? That's the next question. How many housing units are projected? And are there existing apartments that are envisioned to be torn down? Okay, Shiva, go ahead.
Great questions. Thank you. Please feel free to continue asking those questions. We have until 8:30 when we can actually respond to all the questions. The housing depends upon the future market conditions and the amount, the way the area would redevelop. We usually do an analysis, the scenario planning we did that actually tried to see how much potentially each parcel could redevelop and have the built out. For the zoning, you see, we are anticipating at the most 2,300 dwelling units, which is less than the market demand we had seen during, within our market study, we had over 2,600 dwelling units required within this sector plan area. For the, we do anticipate that the Graduate Hills student apartments is not expected to redevelop within in the next 15 to 20 years. But we do anticipate that within 25 years, that would redevelop and it has to be torn down. And most of the parcels we are recommending for the redevelopment of the existing structures that that are there within each property. So, but we are not recommending any changes to the domain apartment. We are expecting that to that already is built out to its density, and it's a great asset for the sector plan area. Scott, would you like to add to that?
No, you covered it.
All right, thank you. Okay, let's keep moving down to these questions. This is a big question, so I will ask this one very slowly. Who did the initial programming to decide that land use one would place high density housing throughout this area? It seems to contradict policy land use two, which is meant to preserve natural areas. So high density housing versus preserving natural areas. The sector plan unfortunately removes many acres of mature forests in what you designate as LTO, or local transit oriented edge. Did the Prince George's County Council decide this? That's the question. Shuba?
Thank you for this question. The plan 2035 has this sector plan area designated as one of the transit centers and directs growth to the center. That means that it is not aligned with the current zoning and the current uses are not appropriate for a transit center in proximity to a university, to a transit area and all the amenities. This sector plan is implementing the goals and vision identified in the countywide comprehensive plan. That's the foundation for this sector plan area recommendations. I would encourage you to look at the natural environment chapter of this sector plan area, which identifies all the strategies to maximize preservation of the natural areas, of the tree canopies, and we are also identifying conservation areas within our public facilities recommendations. Our public facility recommendations identifies 15 acres of conservation area. Currently, the sector plan has around 40 acres of tree canopies. In addition to the 15 acres, we have additional 7 parks recommended for the sector plan area, which will have additional preservation trees that would be preserved. Plus the current ordinance for woodland and wildlife conservation would require each property to preserve 15% of the tree canopies within the within each parcel. So a natural resource inventory would be required for all the properties that lies within the green infrastructure evaluation area that will require for a delineation of all the wetlands and streams or other natural habitats that requires preservation. So in addition to what you already see being preserved on our sector plan, during the development review process, additional areas will be preserved. I hope that answers your question.
Just wanted to add on to what you said. You said that a natural resource inventory is required for properties that are in the green infrastructure network, but there a natural resource inventory is required for all development, and it's a critical beginning step in the development process that requires a property owner to delineate where environmental resources are on their property. And it's really critical when we're reviewing a subdivision or a site plan to know where those environmental assets are, so we can work with property owners during the development process, along with our partners at the Department of Permitting, Inspections, and Enforcement, to really identify where on any parcel development should go, where environmental resources should be preserved and protected, where stormwater management facilities should go. And it really is a great first step in the development process. Now, we were really helped along in this plan process and identifying some of these sensitive areas kind of inadvertently, because the development partnership that was proposing the Western Gateway project, with which you all are all familiar, has an approved natural resource inventory that covers about 25% or more of the plan area. And so that really kind of, we had a lot of the stuff, a lot of the environmental resources already mapped, but that was a really up-to-date source of data that we could pull from identify where the sensitive environmental areas are and what we need to prioritize to protect. It's always a balancing act between development and preservation. And so this plan really tries to strike a balance between what Plan 2035 recommended, which is the type of transit-oriented, mixed-use, walkable development that you need to have around a fixed guideway transit station and a major university, and incorporating and inserting and just trying really hard to create as much environmental protection in sensitive areas, and incorporate and integrate those as best as possible in this area. So that's we really think that this plan is going to provide a blueprint for some of our other station area plans that have similar environmental challenges. Some of our metro stations are located next to sensitive environmental features, and we really want to identify how best to balance the demand for that growth with the need to make sure that it doesn't have a detrimental impact on the environment.
Okay, Scott, thank you for that. Thank you. I want to say very quickly thank you to everyone who's been putting questions in the chat box. It's a very robust question and answer session. We thank you for your participation. So let me get back to the questions. What accommodations have been made for disabled students, faculty, and other users? Shiro, I'll re-ask the question. What accommodations have been made for disabled students, faculty, and other users?
That's a great question. Thank you so much. If you look at our vision and goals, we are talking about inclusive spaces, inclusive community for all age groups and diverse residents of all backgrounds. That means that everything we are recommending will be accessible for all kinds of users. And we are also recommending housing opportunities with universal design, and the parks and recreation facilities we are recommending, as well as the pedestrian and bicycle amenities. Everything we are recommending would be accessible to all population groups.
Shuba, I would just add to that I know that the County Council last year has been looking at legislation to increase, if not, and mandate actually universal design for new residential units. And that's a continued conversation that the Council's having with the Maryland Building Industry Association and other groups to try to really advance universal design as a requirement in the county. And so I would monitor that process as well as the progress of the Housing Opportunities for All work group that the Prince George's County Council has. That's really in the process of developing inclusionary housing policies for Prince George's County. And I know that universal design and accessibility are certainly key elements of that.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you. Next, let me see. Yeah, we asked that one. Okay. All right, we're on track. Next question, are the resource park areas going to be left there today? Are the resource park areas going to be left there today, or are there plans to make them hospitable? This question is about the resource park areas, and are they going to be left there today? Or will they be made hospitable?
Scott, would you like to answer that?
I would say that the parks that are recommended in the plan, I think we're looking at opportunities to make them assets that people can use. Obviously, the parks that we're looking at for conservation purposes, we want to not develop too much so that the natural areas are preserved to the maximum extent possible. But, you know, I think the plan, Shuba, correct me if I'm wrong, the plan has recommendations about I think we talked about exhibits or signage, interpretive signage that talk about the ecosystem and the natural environment. But and we do have a few trails that would go through some of the resource areas, but we do want to limit development of those parks as recreational spaces. You know, to make sure that they're preserved as natural areas as much as possible.
All right, very good. It gets to the next question here. Okay, the next question here is there potential displacement of residents? That is, obviously a very thorny subject usually in development, but let me ask the question one more time. Is there potential displacement of residents? Shuba, I'll give you first crack at that.
That's a great question. If you have seen the initial presentation slides, largely this area has only two apartment dwelling structures. So we have like two apartments where currently residents live. We do have the religious uses in certain parcels, but we haven't seen any potential for any displacement because this is we are accommodating the needs of the community who are currently within the sector plan area. We are also accommodating all the growth needs we see for the next 25 years. And I would like to have Scott answer the rest.
Given that Graduate Hills is being used as a de facto student housing complex that is operated by the University of Maryland, I think that it would be incumbent upon them to replace that housing in kind if they decide to redevelop that site, because it's virtually on-campus housing. Other than that, there are several homeowners in the plan area. I think we have three or four homeowners, maybe five. And they would, you know, they can do with their property what they want. They can stay there as long as they want, or they can sell their property if they want to. But as far as displacement goes, I think it would really be it would be up to the university and how they offer graduate housing options to replace Graduate Hills if that were to be redeveloped. And as we said, that would be 15, 20 years down the road, at which point, if this plan develops as envisioned, there would be more housing options for graduate students. And anyway, what's next, Michael?
Okay, thank you for that answer, Scott. Thank you both, Scott and Shuba. I want to take this opportunity right now to announce the time. It is 8:01. I have 8:01 on my clock. We are scheduled to be here till 8:30. I still want to make sure that we respect everyone's time. So just that friendly announcement. The next question is, Okay. A lot of questions. Could UMD's, the University of Maryland's recent decision to pause development in Guilford Woods impact the final sector plan? It looked like the preliminary plan included new roads through Guilford Woods. So, you're referencing the recent decision that was made by the university to pause development in Guilford Woods. Would it impact that decision? Would it impact the final sector plan? Scott, are you first on this, and then Shuba?
I can take a stab at that one. I mean, short answer is probably not. But the decision really, this is a topic that obviously a lot of people have strong feelings about. And as we told the people who attended last night's open house, and certainly want everyone who's attending tonight, this is an issue that you should submit as testimony at the joint public hearing. This is a decision that's ultimately going to be up to the Prince George's County Council. I think, where the plan comes down firmly on the idea that property, at least the northern portion of that property that's closest to the university campus and the Purple Line Station, should be developed with a mix of walkable uses that allow for people to be able to walk, bike, and take transit to the university without having to use a car, which frankly, has a significant environmental impact that we have to, take into account when we're looking at the development that we recommend in our various plans. Could it play a role in how the county council ultimately determines what to do with this plan? It could. I think that there are a lot of things at play with that property. The Western Gateway project is just one development proposal. It's the latest in a line of development proposals that have occurred for that property and will occur for that property. And like many of you, we eagerly await to see what the university wants to do with it. It's obviously been a very complex challenge for us. At least, the property throughout the development of this plan, that property has been already approved for development, already approved a tree conservation plan that allows the university to, they could go in tomorrow morning deep to Department of Permitting, Inspections, Enforcement, pull a permit and bulldoze the trees tomorrow. They, by right, legally, they could do that. And that's, that kind of puts us in a challenging situation when we're trying to do a plan for a property because it limits the options that are there. So like many of you, we're eager to see what the university has in store next. I think that the fact that the need and the demand for housing that is affordable and proximate to transit and to the university is so great and so important to Prince George's County and to the region, that those pressures will play a great deal in the decision, and it plays a great deal in our decision to recommend development of that property. That's a long way of saying that this is not a cut and dried issue. We have to balance the desire to preserve our environmental resources and our transit station areas with our desire to preserve our environmental resources throughout Prince George's County. It's a 555 square mile county. We have a lot of challenges we're facing, whether it's in the Mattawoman watershed or whether it's at Oxen Cove, where rezoning just occurred that could allow the development of hundreds of acres of existing forest. And we're looking at, you know, we're looking countywide at our different options, but this is certainly something that the county council is aware of, and it's important that your testimony help inform their decision moving forward.
Scott, thank you for that answer. Thank you for answering that. Let me get to the next question, which is a comment and a question. This is going to be a bit of a mouthful. Smart growth does not suggest that every transit node on a rail line like the Purple Line be developed as high-density housing. Areas of natural resources, such as an existing forest canopy, are an asset that can benefit people who could access it such as a station link. So the question following that is, shouldn't the existing woodland be preserved for this purpose? I'll let you take a crack at that.
So I agree that not all transit centers develop alike. Like, we have 26 transit centers. We have like 5 regional centers, and then we have around 20 local centers. Each of them have their designated densities appropriate for that particular station area. This particular station area was identified as a campus center, and it was identified for low to medium density residential dedicated for university students, staff, and for research and businesses to support university work. But we have seen a little bit higher than the initially anticipated development interest in this area following, which was initially identified on Plan 2035. In addition to that, I'll say as planners, we have to take a balanced approach on the development interest we see and the amount of growth we anticipate in certain areas. And we have to identify how best we could achieve some of the countywide goals, the project area related goals, and other competing interests and priorities. For example, there has to be a balanced approach on how much development could occur and should occur in certain areas, and how much preservation could be included within the bounds of a sector plan area. We have identified preservation areas to the best of our capacities, and because we have heard all the concerns from the community from the very first day we have engaged with them for the sector plan area, for the sector plan process. But I would definitely like everybody to share the comments they have on the sector plan recommendations to the county council and to the planning board during the joint public hearing, because it definitely matters what you would like to see in this sector plan area. We have tried to balance the priorities, the competing priorities, as you see, the economic development and the transportation, infrastructural, healthy communities, all those aspects are interconnected, and we have to make decisions as planners using the planning concepts that's based upon data-driven research. So as I mentioned, please provide formal testimonies during the joint public hearing. Thank you. And if Scott wants to add to that, please, Scott.
No, I don't want to add to that. That's very well said. And I echo, you know, there are, you know, there's going to be situations when we're doing a plan where our best professional opinion conflicts with the community's desires or perspectives. And that's, you know, when that happens, and it happens from time to time, it's of great importance that the public testify and let their voices be heard at the joint public hearing. You're absolutely right.
All right, thank you, Shuba. Thank you, Scott. I'm going to give the two of you a small break, and the next question I'm going to direct to our esteemed Countywide Master Planner, Tom Masog. Tom, we have a question for you. Is there an assessment of the commute or all trip mode split and CO2 reduction impact at 22% walk to work rate that would be among the highest in the country? Sounds like somebody speaking your language, Tom, so I'll let you have the floor.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. I'm Tom Masog. Plan 2035 really encourages us to concentrate development into certain areas. If we can get quality mixed-use development near major employment centers like the University of Maryland and near transit like the Purple Line, we can achieve some very good mode share ratios. We've got everything here to really make that happen. You know, the bicycle facilities, the pedestrian facilities, the closeness of everything. It's even walkable to downtown College Park. This is a great place, and even though we didn't explicitly analyze mode shares or CO2, every jurisdiction in the Washington area really has to do their part to encourage development that will reduce CO2.
Tom, thank you for that. Thank you. Appreciate that. Glad you're here with us. Thank you. Let me get to, I understand that somebody, Dennis, is your hand still up? No? Okay. Let me go to the next question. Okay, here we are. What ecological expertise has been and will be available to determine the extent of conservation of the current forested areas? Let me ask that again, and I'll start with Shuba for this. What ecological expertise has been and will be available to determine the extent of conservation of the current forested areas? Shuba, you have the floor.
Thank you, Michael. I would request our environment, our resource team member, Alina, and Scott to answer that. Thank you.
Hi, Alina Perry. I went into that by echoing what Scott said before about the natural resource inventories that are completed for every development application that comes through. And actually for the one that he said had been completed for the area that the Western Gateway project, we actually have added the wetlands that were identified within that natural resource inventory as additions to the green infrastructure network as regulated areas, which get the highest priority for preservation for the natural resources that are provided through the stream and through the wetlands. And we have actually amended that network. So that is something that, again, gets evaluated for each development application. And we have actually taken advantage of the one that was completed previously to update and be more accurate about what's in the area.
Alina, thank you. Go ahead.
I was just gonna add that as soon as we find the right link, we can put a link to the environmental technical manual in the chat. People that are participating can see a little bit more about what property owners have to submit and have reviewed as part of the development review process. While we look at, we do take a broad level look at a master sector plan. We're looking at a higher level using the data that we have on existing tree canopy and wetlands and floodplain and other sensitive environmental resources. Obviously, those evolve over time. And when a development application comes in, we want to have the most current information possible so that we can work with those property owners to preserve those resources and those assets as much as possible. So we can get a link to the environmental technical manual and put it in the chat. Those of you that are interested can take a look at that and see a little bit more about what information has to be gathered and what expertise has to be brought to the table to have those discussions at the time of a development application.
All right, thank you, Scott. And Alina, thank you as well. Thank you for being able to stick with us and answering that question. Let's keep going. I'm looking. Let me take this opportunity to say that it is 8:16. We will probably be doing this for a little less than 10 minutes, so we can still get everybody out at 8:30 and be mindful of everyone's time. I'm going to take these next. I'm going to call an audible here because they're all kind of similar. So Shuba, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to ask all three of these because they're all kind of the same, and you can decide how you want to attack this, attack these questions. So the first question, they all have to do with flooding and downstream and runoff. So the first question, the development of Guilford Woods will add significant flooding downstream. Can the plan address that? And then the next question, the development of Guilford Woods will add, oh no, that's the same question. So there are two questions, I'm sorry. Okay, so let me do that again. The first question, the development of Guilford Woods will add significant flooding downstream. Can't the plan address that? And the second question, why are flood impacts being ignored? There are problems downstream in U Park. So I feel like those are sort of in the same vein. And Shuba, you can attack those questions however you'd like.
Thanks, Michael. Yeah. If everybody has I actually encourage everyone to look at the sector plans national environment chapter. It is broken down into themes which addresses each and every concern and issue and aspects tied to the natural environment. One of the themes is addressing stormwater management issues that currently exist because of the lack of stormwater infrastructure within the sector plan area and on the edges. In addition to that, it also addresses how the future development might impact and might create additional stormwater management needs within the sector plan area. So to begin with, the sector plan recommends that each development should address the stormwater management needs when it redevelops. In addition to that, the all streets we are recommending within the sector plan area will be required to follow the urban street design standards. So if you look at the urban street design standards, the link was provided on our chat here. It requires stormwater management infrastructure to be inbuilt within the street networks, within the right of ways. So all the streets will be addressing, all the new streets will be addressing the stormwater management needs coming from for the construction of those impervious surfaces. I would like Alina to add to that if she has any additional things to share.
Sure, I would just say that one of the recommendations specifically addresses the soils in the area, which do not allow the water to infiltrate as well as possible. And so one of the recommendation strategies says to prioritize underground stormwater management to really slow down the water and to more adequately address the quantity of the water that will be going downstream.
All Thank you, Elena. Thank you. Dennis, are you available now? Your hand is up. All right, Dennis, we're going to go to the next question. Just developing the properties along Campus Drive.
So, Michael, sorry to interrupt. Yes. I think, Dennis, would you like to try unmuting yourself? Because you can unmute yourself and speak, share the question verbally if you want.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, we hear you just fine, Dennis. Sorry about that confusion.
Well, I'm so sorry. I'm trying to work through new technology on my end of this as well. And all I'm seeing is a big orange screen that says Q&A on my tablet, ignoring that for the moment. The issue is that there are significant flood issues here in University Park that come from the streams involved in the area that you're planning. And I'm not sure that there's much thought given to how those impacts might be controlled. There was a development proposed that said that, and it may still be again by the university, that was going to put all that water underground, which is, I think, not possible. I cannot imagine putting 7 inches of water underground on a very small site. So my question is, how is there not a way that this land use plan cannot adjust its priorities so that these flooding issues can be addressed by potentially retention, lower densities, other land use issues, other land use mechanisms. So that's what I was asking, and thank you very much for taking my question.
Thank you, Dennis, for asking the question. And I see Scott is ready to jump in with both feet.
Yeah, I apologize, Shuba. I this is really not my role to answer questions, but I can't help myself because this is an issue that comes up with every single plan that we do. And it's really when you talk about development and stormwater, it's really counterintuitive. The reason why we have flooding anywhere in the United States, but especially in Prince George's County, is because most of our built environment was constructed prior to the 1990s, when we had little to no stormwater management regulation. In the 50s, 60s, 70s, it was, you know, we had the mindset, look, we can land a man on the moon. We can definitely engineer our way out of flooding, which everyone knows really can't happen. And you get things from that era, like the concrete channel that Guilford Run flows into along Guilford Road, or if you're familiar with the concrete channel that Wells Run flows into in the median of East-West Highway. And those were solutions that did not anticipate the additional precipitation that we would be receiving nowadays because of climate change, and because of the development that occurs subsequent to those facilities being constructed. So one of the biggest challenges we have when we discuss this in communities is that when development occurs in Prince George's County, you are required to either control 100% of the stormwater on your property to manage the outflow of stormwater so that it does not contribute to flooding. Or if you have a very small property, to pay a fee to Prince George's County that goes towards stormwater management. One thing that we've been trying to do recently with our plans is identify opportunities for regional or shared stormwater management facilities where multiple property owners can share the cost of a stormwater management facility and the benefits And if the public invests in that, then that makes development more affordable, which, you know, when we're looking at it, we're looking at, well, if a developer doesn't need to spend money on stormwater management, maybe they can spend money on something else that's a community asset. Like more environmental features on their property, more green building, more green building practices in their structures and things like that. What you have here is just like most everywhere else in Prince George's County, an area that developed prior to the 1990s, with no stormwater management to speak of other than storm drains and outflows into streams. In an area that has soils that don't absorb water very well. So when it rains, you still get runoff, even though you have a currently wooded area, it still runs off into the stream and causes downstream problems. I think the approach has been since the 1990s and early 2000s that that's not acceptable anymore. You can't just develop, let the rain fall on a ton of impervious surface, and then, you know, downstream communities have to deal with the impact. We're very sensitive to that. We have an area here along Guilford Run that does flood. And that's something that, you know, I think the plan makes extremely clear that development can't occur here unless we control the stormwater. We cannot exacerbate the downstream flooding. And like I said, it's counterintuitive, but generally when you redevelop properties that developed prior to stormwater management, the net stormwater impact is better. Those of you that live in University Park, you know, through the Prince George's Plaza Transit District Development Plan, we worked very closely with Prince George's County and identified the opportunity for the county to construct a new stormwater management facility upstream in Wells Run that will accommodate the runoff that occurs up there now between Northwestern High School and the new development that's occurring around Prince George's Plaza. And those types of shared facilities help alleviate the cost. And that's what we really hope and recommend happens here. An underground stormwater management facility is expensive. But there aren't very many alternatives here. And that's one that allows for, you know, maximum storage on site, which is what we really want to see. We want to see storage and infiltration on site so that the water doesn't run off and run downstream. If we have development that exacerbates flooding, then we're not doing our job and the development's probably not following the current laws. I know it seems counterintuitive because a lot of people are thinking, well, development equals surface parking lots equals large amounts of impervious surface. And I think what you can see on the renderings and in the text of the plan is our fervent desire to maximize pervious surface, maximize on-site stormwater management, and make sure that the impacts of development that occur anywhere in Prince George's County do not negatively impact the surrounding communities. And that's, you know, that's our goal. It's going to require a lot of community participation in the future. And that's one thing I want to pitch. I know we're at the end of our meeting. I do want to point out the new zoning ordinance that Prince George's County has, because there's a key thing there that is very important to communities. And that is, once the new ordinance takes effect, hopefully next year, it'll be required that every development that's coming in, they have to have a pre-application community meeting with the neighborhood, with the community that's nearby. It needs to be open. I believe it's required to be open to the public. And that is an opportunity for community members to talk to people that are looking to do development in and around your community, and letting them know your concerns right off the bat. And I think that through those conversations with communities, you get to the creative stormwater management that we all like to see and that, you know, we demand as a county. It's important that we do the best we can pursuant to the law make sure that as development comes in, that it is controlling all of its stormwater. But like I said to some of the participants in last night's open house, Once a development comes to the planning department for us to review, it already has an approved stormwater management concept from the Department of Permitting, Inspections, and Enforcement. So once it comes to us, the decision of how stormwater is going to be managed has largely been held already, and that's why it's very important, and that's why we want to require developers moving forward have to meet with the community. They have to collaborate very closely with the community, and they have to really do their homework and present a stormwater management concept to Prince George's County that meets the what we are told every day from developers are extremely stringent stormwater management requirements. Again, they're not retroactive. We can't require places like Lot 1, for example, not to pick on the University of Maryland, but Lot 1 is a massive paved surface parking lot that was developed prior to the advent of stormwater management. And that's, you know, we can't require properties to retrofit, but we certainly advocate for it. And we certainly, in plans where we have a lot of impervious surface, we certainly advocate for it. We advocate for communities to work with the Department of the Environment to identify opportunities to retrofit surface parking lots. And these are going to go a long way. Tree preservation, housing affordability, making sure that we're protecting our watersheds from flooding. These are all countywide issues that are much larger than the 102 acres that we're working on right here. And just because it's not part of this specific plan doesn't mean that we're not working on these issues. We're trying to take a holistic viewpoint at that. I just filibustered, Michael. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to take up all the time with the answer, but this topic does come up a lot, and it's not black and white. Development often, when especially when we're talking about infill, does not equal more impervious surface. Often it results in less. But again, these are areas that we have to do a good job of informing the community and you know, working very closely with developers as they bring a project online.
Okay, Scott, thank you for that. It is my clock says 8:32, and so we're a little beyond, but so we're going to move forward. We're not really able to take any more questions if we're going to be respectful of everyone's time. But what I do want to say is that we know that there are some questions that we weren't able to get to. We thank you for the questions that were asked. And so we will be getting back to, we will be still trying to answer the questions that that weren't answered, and we'll follow up with them. We'll follow up with you We'll follow up with answering those questions and put them on our website. So I want to wrap up. I want to say thank you to everyone who came and brought your questions. We hope that that we were able to answer questions that if not now, then in the future we'll be able to answer those questions. Or thank you for that. I want to take the opportunity to again invite you to review the preliminary sector plan. We encourage you to be a part of the joint public hearing Tuesday, January 18, 2022, 5 p.m. We've been putting the links in the chat again, but we'll do it again as well. Just to remind you, we encourage you to submit testimony in writing to the clerk of the county council. And for those of you who are not able to use the portal, send your correspondence, email it to clerkofthecouncil@co.pg.md.us or fax it to 301-952-5178. Please remember that testimony is only going to be taken in only be accepted in electronic format. And so to find out more, next slide, please take note of our project website. We're going to put chats, links in the chat stay on top of updates and stay on top of and also, like I said before, take a look at what we've done in the past over the course of the project, our community engagement activities, especially and also prior community meetings that we've had, and also the plan is there, the SMA is there, everything that you'd ever want, how to contact us, all of that's going to be on the website. And then finally, the last slide, that's my contact information. I'm the deputy project manager. That's Shuba's contact information. She is the project manager. We are available for questions or comments concerning the plan. We are thankful that you were able to grace us with your presence today. Didn't want to take too much time. I know we're overboard, but I want to thank you again for taking time out of your busy schedule. We appreciate you. We tried to answer all your questions. We'll keep trying, okay? And stay in touch. Thank you for your time, and please have a wonderful rest of the week. Thank you for coming.